small town person taking the train into the bright lights of New York City, baby, back in the day, trying to make it big because they're a star. It's a very exhilarating feeling, just looking up at the buildings and really feeling like you're a small fish in a big pond. So I had no idea how textured Edinburgh is, and I'm not just talking about the cobblestones, which me and my rolling luggage were very aware of, but the city itself, how many hills and stairways there are, just really how up and down it is. My Google Maps was taking me down these narrow, what are called closes. They're narrow alleyways, mostly made up of stairs, and with my, at that point, jam-packed luggage, it was miserable. It was like when I went on a dark history tour in Seoul, South Korea. We were going down an alley, and my guide mentioned when he was taking a group of people down that way previously, they had turned a corner, and there were two drunk guys peeing on the street, and they just said, "Welcome to Korea." So all of the stairs a little bit felt like welcome to Edinburgh. Now, London was beautiful and interesting, and I'm so grateful that I was able to experience it. I know I'll be back very soon, but this city really had my heart. I was absolutely mesmerized. Every corner I turned, every shop I perused, every nook and cranny just blew me away. There were two occasions where I was just strolling along, minding my business, listening to a bagpiper on a street corner, and I just start tearing up like I didn't have control over my body. On this leg of the trip, I stayed in a hostel. It was my first hostel experience, and I actually stayed in a pod capsule situation, like what you'd popularly see in Japan. I loved it, and they had a bar on the first floor, and on the first night, I chilled down there and got to talking with a guy from California and a guy from Australia for 4 hours. Then a group, a bachelor party or a stag party, whatever you please, came by and started doing karaoke. So I was multiple hard ciders in, and we were all shouting Mr. Brightside. So it was a great way to kick off my stay. So seriously, prepare yourselves for some graveyards, because I spent so much of my time here in them. Like, I stopped by Greyfriars 7 times. I think it's only fair that we honor that by telling some local ghost stories and legends throughout my ramblings. Nothing too crazy. Don't worry if you're not into that, but let's start with Edinburgh Castle, which is right there on the hill. It dates back to the 12th century. Perhaps the most famous of Edinburgh Castle's spooks is the ghostly Piper, who was supposedly sent into the tunnels under the castle a few hundred years ago to explore, but never returned. So there have been multiple reports of bagpipes being heard underneath the castle and underneath the Royal Mile ever since. My first afternoon in the city, I signed up for a 3.5-hour Harry Potter tour. I did one in London as well as here, primarily because it's just a great way to see the city, as you see a lot of the main sights, but also more fun and obscure details through the lens of Harry Potter. So we met outside the Balmoral Hotel, where J.K. Rowling finished The Deathly Hallows. In room 552. She ended up moving in there so she could write in peace, and when she finished the book, she picked up a pen and scribbled on a bust of Hermes, like J.K. city, you definitely feel that magical inspiration. For me, more than in London, but it makes sense as this is where J.K. Rowling has spent most of her life. We're inside John Kay's bookshop, where I picked up Harry Potter written in Scots, which a lot of you on Instagram are going crazy over. And then I also picked up an illustrated Sherlock Holmes book. You'll see both of those eventually, but there is some fun shopping to do in this city. I didn't tempt myself by going into a vintage clothing store because my suitcase was full, but there were some eccentric and interesting art shops, oddity shops, Halloween stores, stuff like that. We are going to make our way over to Greyfriars Kirkyard soon, where you may be familiar with the story of Greyfriars Bobby. Greyfriars Bobby was a little terrier who lived from 1855 to 1872. His owner died when the dog was 2, so he spent the next 14 years of his life guarding his owner's grave. He also kind of became the city's dog, with townspeople playing with him, feeding him, bringing him toys and sticks. There's a grave marker in the cemetery for him, and it's covered in the sticks people still leave for him to this day. J.K. Rowling spent a lot of time walking around the cemetery, so you'll definitely see some Harry Potter names if you're here, like McGonagall, Moody, Thomas Riddle, Lupin. So this place had some heavy influence. The graveyard could also be home to a much more sinister inhabitant. There were always spooky stories linked to Greyfriars, but specific references to the Mackenzie poltergeist began in the late 1990s. The story goes that the poltergeist was disturbed after a homeless man seeking shelter broke into the mausoleum, prompting a series of regular and violent ghostly attacks on innocent passers-by. More than 350 people reported being attacked in this area of the graveyard between 1990 and 2006, but ghost tours still visit the Mackenzie's mausoleum. Visitors often mention feeling a strong sense of unease, as well as unexplained cuts, bruises, and scratches. It's interesting because I, at the time, wasn't aware of this story, but walking around the graveyard, I was looking into different mausoleums and gates, but for some reason, when I walked up to that one, I almost put my face up to the bars to look inside, but I was overcome with such a feeling of, no, 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 don't do that. It's the round one on the right, but I immediately turned and walked away. I feel like people think I'm scared all the time because of my demeanor during my creepy story reading videos, but honestly, I'm really chill in real life. I'm not super easily spooked. With the videos, it's just fun to give into the creepiness and be dramatic, you know? But day to day, it's rare that I'm overcome with fear like that. So, peculiar stuff. Alright, so I could do a video attempting to read Harry Potter in Scots, but will I? Bibliophile ASMR, my husband, best friend, sister, wife, brother, told me to, but I mean, he's just encouraging a hot mess, you know? I honestly feel like it would be painful, especially for those of you that are, in fact, Scottish, so not sure if I'm gonna put you through that. We'll see. I did go on two ghost tours while here. The first was a small group. There were only four of us, so it was super chill and conversational. We walked around the Royal Mile and different closes, and we went back to Greyfriars. The most disturbing surgeons, all museums. Oh my god, photography wasn't allowed, otherwise I would have shown you guys around, but I strongly suggest Google image searching the name of the museum because you'll see everything. They have thousands of specimen jars showcasing medical anomalies and ailments. I mean, truly, body parts out the wazoo. It was crazy seeing preserved body parts from the 1800s, or whenever they were preserved, which blew my mind. If you're not squeamish with medical stuff, I could not recommend this enough. There were a few instances where I gasped out loud, but one was with a preserved fish, and the story behind it is that a man was fishing and he was drawing in the net with both hands. Because both of his hands were occupied, he put this fish in his mouth. The fish then wriggled its way down the man's throat, and he suffocated. This story was published in 1813. So reading that story and staring at the fish that a man over 200 years ago choked on was wild. The museum also has objects related to William Burke and William Hare. So between 1827 and 1829, Edinburgh was home to the two most famous body snatchers, Burke and Hare. During this time, the need for corpses grew to meet with anatomy research taking place in Edinburgh. In order to meet the demand, the black market of body snatchers had a roaring trade, buying and selling stolen human bodies. So, Burke and Hare turned to murder to fuel their sales. At the museum, they have Burke's death mask and pocketbook made from his skin after his public dissection, after his public hanging. Sorry, I'll stop there, but to me, medical history is so fascinating, so that museum was incredible. In the graveyards, you'll see some graves with cage-like contraptions encapsulating them, which was to prevent grave robbing. After the two caged graves, you'll see a grave lacking one, which looks vulnerable, but there were still some tricks in place to deter grave robbers. You'd think, especially with the lip, which you'll see on the edge of the grave marker, you could ram a shovel down there and pry it up, but there were some graves that had a sort of metal sheet or something in the ground, so if a shovel were to be rammed in the dirt on top of it, there would be a huge clang alerting those around that someone was trying to snatch a body. After this, I went to the Museum of Context on Victoria Street, which was super neat. There aren't a lot of Harry Potter shops I would recommend. Like, I don't have interest in going in and seeing the same Harry Potter merch again and again, but the Museum of Context had some very unique wares and goodies. Also, it's a shop and not a museum, but it is called the Museum of Context. Okay, Mary's Milk Bar, Sweet Fancy Moses. This was good stuff. I got an espresso, plum sorbet, and cinnamon cherry ice cream. Still my favorite ice cream place is Milk Jam in Minneapolis, so if you're in Minnesota, definitely put that on your radar. No, this was the next day, people. Okay, I went to get some donuts. This one is a rhubarb rose, and my mouth is watering. It was so good. Someone on my England vlog was like, "Holy shit, you eat a lot." And I don't think they realized I was there for over a week. Like, I wasn't eating all of that. spend almost what felt like a full day in Edinburgh, especially because I had not walked up to Galton Hill, which, I mean, you see the views for yourself. They are spectacular.